ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। दीज थिंग्स दैट एंड विथ शांति 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 ही लाइक दिस they are called not unsurprisingly shanti mantras. So there are many shanti mantras in the Vedantic literature, and the shanti mantras, there are different shanti mantras in the antabhaga of the different Vedas, the four Vedas, the Yajurveda, Rigveda, Samaveda and Atharvana Veda. They have different shanti mantras. And of course, the Dasha Upanishads are also in the different Vedas. And hence, each Upanishad has got a particular Shanti Mantra associated with it. And when Shankara writes his Bhashya on the 10 Upanishads, and when he comes into contact with one Shanti Mantra in the first instance, then he also writes a Bhashya on the Shanti Mantra. And the Shanti Mantra Bhashyas by themselves are absolutely brilliant. So if you see the Shanti Mantra on Purnamada itself, full of Vedanta is there in the Purnamada Shanti Mantra Bhashya. In fact, full of Vedanta is there in that mantra itself. But we are not able to see it. So we have to read the Shankara Bhashya to be able to understand what that is. So the reason why I started today with this sahana vavatu is because I am going to talk a little bit today about the, I'm obviously, as you can tell, going to touch upon various Upanishads but not go too deeply into any one of them, much as I would like to. If I did that, then we'd be here for a long, long time. So today I'm going to talk about touch upon things that are there in the Taittiriya Upanishad. Of course, the Taittiriya Upanishad is Upanishad in the Yajurveda. And it's got the Shanti Mantra associated with it, is Sahana Bhavatu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karabhavai. We can maybe talk if we have some time later about what these Shanti Mantras mean. But the Taittiriya Upanishad comes in three pieces. They are called Vallis. Actually, it comes in four pieces, but the fourth piece is called Mahanarayana Upanishad. Then it's of a different nature altogether. It is a very Upasana based. So the Taittiriya Upanishad is normally taken as three Vallis. And again, especially about Taittiriya Upanishad and Kathopanishad, I could speak for a long, long time because I personally am very, very fond of them. My gurus are also very fond of these Upanishads. So there is the starts with the Shiksha Valli. The first Valli is called the Shiksha Valli. The second Valli is called the Brahmananda Valli. And the third Valli is called Bhrigu Valli. Okay, so this is just, I don't know why I'm telling you this, because this is information. This is not meant to be a set of informational talks. But then when it comes to Taittiriya Upanishad, all naturally when you're talking about something that you're very fond of, you feel like saying something about it. So last time we spent some time trying to see, okay, what is that common denominator that underlies all our experiences? And then we also spoke a little bit about Kala being a Jagat Bhakshaka. and yet also somehow mysteriously being a Jagat Rakshaka, because if it was only doing Bhakshana of a finite universe, after a while the universe would be swallowed up by it. So there is something that even when Kala destroys it, it keeps on reviving in spite of all destruction, and we have to think, what is that thing? So somewhere inside us, there is a fundamental cause, a center. All change is happening with the center and anchor. In fact, in general, if you have to describe anything that is changing, you have to describe it while holding something constant. If nothing is constant, then no change has any meaning. Then you know, it's chaos. But when you have something constant and then you're seeing something change, then you can describe the change in the context of something that is constant. It's a very rational approach to figuring out change. So that every change brings about a newness while the center remains unchanged. So in fact, if Kala is doing Bhakshana of Jagat, and you animate that aspect of Kala in your mind as doing Bhakshana of Jagat, then you must think, okay, this Kala is doing Bhakshana of the Jagat, but that Kala must be regulated by somebody then. Somebody must be, you know, controlling that Kala. And if it's controlling that Kala, then Kala can't do Bhakshana of that thing also, right? So you have to try to catch hold of that thing, which is the master of what you appear to be. And then perhaps you will find that master is somewhere, is really what you are. So what you appear to be, you have to find what is the master of that thing. So Bhashyakara says, yes, you know, you play as a child, balastavat krida saktaha. Then you, as a youth, you indulge your desires. There's no problem with these per se, but parabrahmani kopina lagna. The problem is, if you have that asakti towards parabrahmani, then all these other things, your play, your desires, all have some meaning. There is no need to do chintana and no need to be overcome by chintana. So the question is, how do you catch hold of that parabrahman? So this was Bhrigu's question. Okay, so again, I just helplessly, I'm going to read out a section of Taittiriya Upanishad, not because it might make a lot of difference to you, but because it makes a lot of difference to me. So the Bhriguvalli of, it's called Bhriguvalli, it's named after Bhrigu. And it is, for all this, we'll get to the Kathopanishad later, which I hope to tell you the story of. But you take all these Upanishads, you know, they are all greatly dramatic Upanishads and they are great, great stories. Where, of course, you know, in the Bhagavad Gita, you saw that, you know, roughly the chariot driver became the guru just by asking the question. So imagine if you're driving around in your car and your driver is driving it, suddenly he becomes a guru. If you ask the right driver the right question, he becomes a guru and you become the shishya. So this is the same thing as a father. So it's, the Upanishad is so beautiful, and of course, these are such deep truths. The Upanishad never wastes a single word or a single syllable also. Okay. So you have to imagine the drama of the Upanishad. There is a boy, he has gone to his guru, he has gone to the ashrama, studied for so many years, then he's come back home. Now in the case of Bhrigu, Varuna is his father, that's the great rishi. But who can appreciate that great rishi, Varuna, until you have gone to the other ashrama and seen what the other standard issue guru is. And you come back now and now you see this father here and you see, you still haven't understood anything, really beginning to understand things. And you're lucky, you are the son of Varuna. So you have somebody else to ask. Most other students will go back home and their father may not be able to tell them anything. But not so for Bhrigu. He could ask his father. So he came back home and he knows a lot of things. He knows everything. But now he doesn't, also at the same time, doesn't know anything. So it says, Bhriguvai varunihi varuna pitara upasasara adhihi bhagavo brahmeti. That's all. Bhriguvai varunihi. He is the son of Varuna. That's all. Varuna pitara pitaram upasasara. He goes to his father. Now, in this fact that he goes to his father, you must understand that he has gone to the ashram, he has done everything, he has studied all the Veda, Vedanga, everything, he knows everything and yet he knows nothing. So he has gone to his father. He has gone to his father because he now wants to start learning. He has learned all the things. The preliminary work is all the kindergarten stuff has been done. Kindergarten stuff is not easy, but he has done it. Great tapasya and all. He has done yajna, he has sung the songs, he has recited the Veda. Everything has happened. And then he comes to the father and says, Adhihi Bhagavo Brahma. Please teach me. Adhihi Bhagavo Brahma, you have to teach. You have to say to the guru when you approach him for Brahma Vidya. It is a formal approach to the guru for Brahma Vidya, and it is indeed probably very rare in these days to have a guru who you will have an opportunity to approach with the right way. But you cannot just approach this guru in the afternoon casually, and you know, after having a cup of coffee, you can't go over to the guru's place and say Adihi Bhagavo Brahmani. that is not the approach. This is, you have to have fasted for so many days. First, you should have done a lot of preparatory work. The guru should have thought about you a lot. You should have thought about the guru a lot. Somehow you should have agreed that he will give you some great Brahma Vidya. Then the day will be fixed. Then you will go with all the fruits and the flowers and all. There will be no public there. There will be no people hanging around helping you, etc. It will just be you and guru. And it is not like a normal mantra diksha at all. Maybe some people have had. It is not like that. It's a much more secret and solemn thing. So suppose somebody might have gone for mantra diksha at some place. They might have had people sitting around helping them with a few things. It's a much more serious matter. So then this guy went to his father, Varuni, Adihi Bhagavan, Adihi Bhagavo Brahman. So he says that. And he realized Parabrahmani Gopina Lagna. He has to have Lagna and Parabrahma. How to do? So Bhrigu told him that in which everything resides is Brahman. Okay, that's fine. So give me a way of getting in touch with that Brahman. I want to get in touch with that Brahman. How do I catch hold of that Parabrahman? And Bhrigu is not, Varuna is not given to detailed instructions. He gives a short instruction. Tapaso Brahma Vijignasasva. Finished. That's the full instruction. You have done. I've answered your question. Please go away and work on it. By tapas, inquire into Brahma. This is what he's told. What is tapas? Tapas means to intellectually investigate something deeply with single-mindedness. That is the tapas of this context. Even Manu, when he describes in his Smriti the rules by which humankind conducts itself, has placed tapasya in a very high spot. Okay, tapasya is a very, very important thing. So much so, it is said that the entire creation happens because of tapasya. In one place, it is said that when that creative energy arose in the Brahma Chaitanya, then the divine Chaitanya expanded because of tapasya. And in that expansion, the universe burst forth. How is that expansion? The expansion is likened to how it is when a seed bursts forth, expands when it's fed with water, and out of that comes the beautiful plant. That is tapas. Now, of course, when you hear this word tapas, you imagine all kinds of things. But Brahman, of course, has got no legs and hands. So don't imagine a man with a big beard standing on one leg and doing tapas. So, satyam jnanaha tapah. The Upanishad itself defines this tapas as jnanamai tapah. This is the tapas we have to do. Now, what does the word itself mean? The word itself has got to capture something which is difficult to do. Kashta sahanam tapah. This is a very gross sthula. I'll use the word sthula often. Sthula means gross. Characterization of tapas. Enduring any difficulty. Not just any difficulty that happens to fall on your head, But you take the difficulty, you find it, you choose it, you take it upon yourself, and you endure it. When you endure a tapas like this, by this your power increases, it doesn't decrease. This is the normal, common meaning of tapas. Now, what about jnanamai tapas? What can be the difficulty with jnanam? The difficulty with jnanam is the tools of jnanam are strewn here and there everywhere. To gather the tools of jnanam and focus them is difficult. Okay, that's the difficulty of jnanamai tapas. If you tell somebody, here is the flowing river, here is the water, build a dam and stop the flow of this water, he'll do it. With the right engineering talent, he will do it. If you tell the man, put a dam in the flow of your thoughts, you find it very difficult. Okay. So, manaschaindriyanam cha hi ekagriyam. That is tapas. This is the greatest tapas. Single-mindedness and a concentration of mind and all the sense organs is very difficult, and hence it is the greatest tapas. Now, when Brahman did tapas, there was neither mind nor organs. He just expressed the love within himself. If you want to express that knowledge, you have to use the human experience, because all you have is the use of the human body. So, when Bhrigu was ready to go into the depths of Brahma Vidya, his guru Varuna told him, Tapasa Brahma Vijigyasasva. He gave him a master key. Only one answer. Tapasa Brahma Vijigyasasva. What is the beauty of the master key? The master key is it can open all the locks. So when Bhrigu enters the Atma Tattva, he finds different locks. He can use the same master key to open all the locks. Tapasa Brahma Vijigyasasva. What are those locks? There are five locks, and that is what is called Pancha Kosha. Taittiriya Upanishad is famous for the Pancha. Famous for so many things. But it's particularly famous for Pancha Kosha. Inside that, the Atma Tattva sits silently overflowing with joy. Now, Kosha is the name given to treasure chest, in which there is a treasure, and naturally treasure chests, if the treasure is worth anything, it will be locked quite securely. And this has got the greatest treasure of them all. It has got the Atma Ratna. So it has to be kept very carefully and hidden very carefully. And the way, of course, this is a great master artist hiding something. So the best way to hide something is to keep it there plain and open sight. So if you look at the human being, there is the greatest Atma Ratna hidden this, and you can't even tell where are the locks, etc. You can't say, what is this? Yet they are open for everybody to see is the truth. So you have to investigate very carefully, find the locks and open them with a master key. So you start with what you can see. You start with the body. The body appears jada. It is insentient. Jada is a word for insentient. Now, once you see an insentient thing, you know that the Upanishad can have nothing to do with it. Because the Upanishad can't be wasting its time talking about jada objects. When you read the Upanishad and you worry about some interpretation of something, you need to have great faith that the Upanishad will not waste its time talking about obvious things, talking about things that you can find out in your history, physics, chemistry book, or talking about some lifeless object. So when you're trying to interpret some statement in the Upanishad, you can get rid of all the possible Upanishad interpretations that have these as the interpretation. So the Upanishad's approach is different. After all, when the Upanishad ends this Panchakosha Vishleshana, the investigation into the Panchakosha, it says, Anandam Brahmano Vidvan Na Bibeti Kutaschaneti. At the end of the Panchakosha process, it says, you will know that true and infinite joy in a way such that you will be free from all fear. So this approach to Panchakosha is the upasana of ananda. And a jada object cannot have any ananda. In fact, our mistake is, as you keep doing upasana of jada objects, you also get dried up and become jada and distant from ananda. So the Panchakosha is not some investigation of jada layers. You have to understand that from the beginning. Now again, you take the body and look at the body, which is a living body. This is not a medical class. But you know, if you do a dissection of a corpse, you will figure out here are the bones, here is the tongue, here is the blood vessels, etc. And this is the approach of the body as a jada. So no matter how much detail you get into with this jada body, you will not get vairagya. Vairagya means detachment. Okay. In fact, if you will open the body and you find out, as you already know, that the body consists of blood and white blood cells and pus and all the other disgusting things, that knowledge is not enough to get rid of your obsession with your body. You're not going to suddenly get vairagya because of knowing all this. Because the jada is not going to give you vairagya. You start with the jada, the Upanishad says, that's all right, but go to the root of it. After all, the body is not dead. It is full of life. Where is that life coming from? For that, you have to look deep inside and you will find, inside is just a word, you will find anandam brahma, brahma puccham pratishtha. At the very root of the body, Brahman is sitting. You don't have to go anywhere, but we go around looking. It's inside, but we go around looking for the truth, and because we don't find it, we are weeping. But in fact, there is no real cause for failure and hopelessness. Just like, suppose, you know, you get allocated a piece of land by the government, perhaps for free, and you want to start farming there. But let's say the monsoon rains failed and there is no rain, and you invested all this money in the seeds and all these things. And now you're crying that, oh my God, I can't grow anything in this land. But unbeknownst to you, under that same plot of land, suppose there is a large buried treasure. Then you're sitting on that kind of treasure, but you can't do anything with it because you don't know that you have that treasure. Situation is pretty similar for the way you're dealing with life and this body that you have. This body, you know its existence. Existence is Sat. Sat is Chit, living consciousness. And the same Chit is Ananda. And although this treasure trove is there within you, we are regarding things from the outside and crying that things are not working. So it says, the Upanishad assures you, you just try to go within. And for this going within, it's unlike in the land, you don't need any spades or some special instruments to dig. You just need to sit with your eyes closed and contemplate tapasa brahma vijignyasasva. So in the Bhriguvalli, what exact methods he used is not told. You have done tapas, you have done vichara, going from there are the koshas are given, the annamaya to pranamaya, pranamaya to manomaya, manomaya to vijnanamaya, vijnanamaya to anandamaya, and there finally the story ends. It's not the end of the story, but the story ends there. But to do this journey, you need some methods. So before the Bhriguvalli in Taittiriya Upanishad, this is a Brahmanandavalli. And there the method is told. How to go from one kosha to other kosha to discover the Ananda within, that is told. And the concepts are further laid out later in the Bhriguvalli, which methods are told beautifully in the Brahmanandavalli. So I'll give you an idea of how these things are laid out. But Taittiriya Upanishad is too much. So you have to be better served by a careful study of Taittiriya Upanishad word by word if the conversation today intrigues you somewhat. So you start with the Annamaya Kosha, the first kosha, the body, the physical body, the one that is visible from the outside. Notice we call it the Annamaya Kosha and not the Annamaya Sharira or the Annamaya Deha, because once you use these words, you have to use these Sanskrit words very carefully. Implications creep in the moment you use the word. So, sharira, kshiyate iti sharira, that which decays is the sharira. Or deha, deha is that which is burnt when it's old and reduced to ashes. Now, we are in the Upanishads, we can't be regarding something that is kshiyate iti sharira or something that gets burnt up. So, we call it a kosha. So, we call it annamaya atmanam. It is the Annamaya Atma. So what is Anna? What is Anna itself? You should be, somebody asks you what is Anna. Some random person asks you what is Anna. You say Anna, you know, it is this roti, dal, rice, eating. What, that's all it is. Eating, eating, eating the whole day we are doing anyway. But the moment you are in an Upanishadic class, you become alert. And the teacher says, what is eating? What is this consumption? And then you realize that the magic of consumption is an absolute miracle. Because what happens in consumption? there is a thing outside you, okay? You take it into your mouth. The gulab jamun is there. You take the gulab jamun into your mouth, and then the next moment, that gulab jamun is me. It has gone from being idam, this, to aham, me. I mean, it is pure magic. And the way that magic happens is already encoded in the language. This is the brilliance of Sanskrit. Everybody should, at least if they get nothing from these classes, they should be inspired to study the Upanishad, and before that they have to study Sanskrit. Because without that, you can't really do anything. So why? Because you see, the word Anna comes from Ad Dhatu. Dhatu means the verb root, Ad. Okay. Atti means he eats, At. Now, out of this root, two words can be formed. One is Anna and other is Atma. One is the eaten and other is the eater. And they come from the same root. So this is a peculiarity of the way the Vedanta is laid out. It's not a peculiarity, it is a beauty actually. If you see the Panchikarana and the way the universe is created, there is a parallel universe created outside you and inside you. And when the objects of the sense organs are created, they are created by the same parts that the corresponding sense organ is created. The smell is created by the same things, same mixture that nose is created. So similarly, Atma and Anna come from the same root. Okay. So if you want to accept Anna, accept it. Then in order to consume that Anna, you need a body, and yet the Lakshana of Atmanam has to be put into work. So the question is, do you need Anna for the body, or do you need the body for Anna? See, we are all taught under a Western system that you need Anna to sustain the body. But in fact, you need the body for the Anna, otherwise you can't consume. You cannot, that it doesn't become an Anna. The Anna will become Anna only if it can be a thing outside, be idam, and go inside and become aham. For that, you need the body. The body is providing the machine that does that magical work. So if you start saying for the body you need Anna, and you know the Anna needs the body to consume it, then you get stuck in a circular reference. But that circular reference is a circular reference of insentient thing. It is a jada circularity. And you will remain stuck in that jada if you think that circularity is important. So from a sophisticated perspective, you look at the body by going into its root. Who is it that embraces the body, accepts the body, and owns the body? I do. Through Anna, and hence I am Atma. Okay. If I am going to manifest, I have to accept the body to manifest. So I am accepting this body to manifest. If I don't think like this, body is a mere jail. Instead, the body is a place where the Atma Tattva is manifested. I manifest through my own power and my own Mahima. What is your great Mahima? My Mahima is this. You put the Gulab Jamun in front of me and goes into my stomach and it becomes me. You do that and show? You can't do it. You put it in a machine and show that Gulab Jamun will be there in the machine. It will come out, drop, plunk out of the machine. It will not become part of the machine. It will not become a screw in that machine suddenly. That Gulab Jamun will come right out. It will spoil, in fact, it will spoil the machine. So this ability is the Mahima, Atma Mahima. To think like this is the Upasana of the Annamaya Kosha, not a Jada, not the Jada Sharira, but the Annamaya Kosha. In reality, in the Brahmananda Valli, this is explained tersely by the phrase Anna Rasamaya Purushaha. Take Anna, convert it into Rasa, and spread yourself out in that Rasa, make it a part of you. This is Purusha. Only Purusha can do this. Purnat Purusha. This is how the Purusha is becoming Purna. Here we are giving importance to the Rasa, the tapasya of the Annamaya Kosha. Remember, tapasya is the master key to unlock every kosha. So far as the Annamaya Kosha goes, the tapasya is that your life becomes rasamaya even at the grossest level. Hence, every bodily activity of the Annamaya Kosha has to be performed with this Atma Drishti and with full attention. You walk, you roam about, you climb, you use your hands, you eat, you sleep. You do everything through that Atma Drishti. Thus, in describing the Annamaya Kosha, he uses the words idam and I am in the Upanishad. Idam means this, this. It is pratyaksha, it is a patent, tangible, visible presence. And you have a direct experience of this. And the direct experience is connected with you without that feeling of, with that feeling of atmiyata. This is part of me, the Atma. When you use every part of your body with that atmiyata, then in all your efforts, there is a certain rhythm. The legs won't wander off and the hands won't flail about uncontrollably. And if you do excess work, you won't just get tired. You will get hungry. So you will eat. And when you eat, your body will convert that food into rasa and yourself, and you will be sustained. This is very important. So my guru tells the story of, you know, when he in his younger days used to go to Calcutta often, and there was a man there called Ghosh Babu who spent all his time coaching young people on bodybuilding. And so when Swamiji went there, he asked them to come to give a demonstration. And after watching the demonstration, the Swamiji was so impressed. He said, "This is really fantastic, these people. What kind of supplements do they take? You know, do they take nuts, fruits, milk, protein? What do they do?" He said, No. These are just poor Bengali kids. So they only take that what we call, you know, kanji in Tamil. It is just simple rice and water. So the mahima is not what they're eating, but the mahima is the exercise routine and the intelligent way in which they are using every part of the body. So that is a fantastic thing. And if you join Atma Chintana to this, then this bodybuilding becomes more than a kala. It becomes a puja and it becomes a part of spiritual sadhana. The spiritual sadhana of Annamaya Kosha can be found in many surprising places, such that the level of consciousness, even at the time of the exercise, is prominent and tangibly and palpably present in the body, and it's able to then govern the body even as you're acting as the body. So now this has got to do with hunger, and some people say, well, this matter of hunger and eating is not to do with the Annamaya, it has got to do with the Pranamaya. And to an extent that is true, because hunger and thirst are characteristics of the Pranamaya Kosha. So what is this Pranamaya Kosha? So we have to go to the kosha that pervades the Annamaya Kosha at a subtler level, and it is called Pranamaya Kosha. So what does this Pranamaya Kosha mean? So if the Annamaya is the gross physical manifestation, then the Pranamaya is the functionality of that physical system. It is the carrier of the volitional forces of the human body. Through that, the body does the five types of karma. Hence, the Shastra speaks of Pancha Prana. So Prana, Apana, Vyana, Udana, Samana, you might not have heard. I'll not be explaining that in great detail right now. It might be worthwhile looking into some Upanishadic text. Each of them has a certain functionality. Prana does purification, protection. Apana eliminates waste, impurities. Vyana permeates the body, oversees it. Udana causes the movement of the physical body. And Samana extracts and consumes the rasa from the anna. So just like in any society of people, any group of people, various functions are divided. Like that, the pranas are divided up and forming the functionality of the human system. But as you know, if you ever try to organize anything among people, it's not easy. It doesn't happen by itself. You can't put 20 people in a room and say, organize yourself. You know, it will not be like that. Somebody has to do this, has to organize it. Otherwise, if you put 20 people in a room, you'll only get chaos. So, how is it organized? So, but the practice of yoga, the control and the oversight of the pancha pranas can be done under your control. But what does yoga require? Yoga requires the power of the mind. And so you naturally get to the point that over and above the prana shakti is the mano shakti. It is subtler and even more stronger. So just as anna is for the annamaya kosha, okay, prana is for the manomaya kosha. Without anna, the body will fall. And without prana, the mind will leave the body. The sukshma sharira will leave the body. You will say, sharir thanda pad gaya. That means the sukshma sharira has left the body. Because prana is not there. Actually, I don't know if you all, any of you have had experience of this or read about this in the old days. I don't know old days, because maybe it's there even in the new days. But there were Russian mystics. The Russian mystics were always used to try to justify their mysticism by lab experiments. So some Russian mystics had learned to take photographs of aura, you know, and they demonstrated this well. They took a photograph of a leaf and its aura, then they cut the leaf in half and immediately took a photograph, and the aura photograph was still covering the whole leaf just for a few seconds. Somehow the rest of the leaf was still there on that aura photography, whatever it is. I'm not very clear exactly what they were using. So this is roughly like taking photographs of the sukshma sharira, if that's possible. The pulsation of prana is somehow captured in this. Okay. So the question is, what happens to that sukshma, that subtle part? So in the mind, there is this mind. There is the subtle part. But what is the mind? The mind is just a storehouse of knowledge that is gathered by experiential events. It's giving a lot of knowledge, lots of factors come in from the eyes, the ears, and all these experiences come in, and the mind gathers all this information. And it is there, it presents various aspects of the world. Who is going to use all that information? Somebody who's got to use that information has to be full of knowledge and really intelligent. That intelligent thing that is going to use all the information of the mind is called the buddhi. It is the decisive factor. It uses its power to take all the data provided in the mind and come to a conclusion. And until you come to a conclusion, you can't act. Pros and cons are good. But with just pros and cons, if you try to act, it'll be random and there'll be no beauty and no depth in it. When buddhi takes the pros and cons, processes it, arrives at a definite conclusion, perhaps sometimes a wrong conclusion, but a definite conclusion, then you can generate creative action. Not that creative action is always correct action, but it is definitive action. So buddhi is a higher order of knowledge that deals with growth and combines informational knowledge generated by the mind and decides this. It is said that there was an Indian woman who went to Germany. And in those days, it wasn't like this with all these cooking channels and MasterChef and all. So she was demonstrating how to make rotis. And the German lady was very fascinated that you make rotis like this. So the Indian lady demonstrated. And of course, Germans are very precise. So after all this, he said, okay, to make a half a kilo of atta, exactly how much water do you need? And the Indian lady said, you need exactly as much as it takes to make half a kilo of atta. So she doesn't know the exact measure, but the exact measure is there in the buddhi. Similarly, in every interaction, no matter how simple a person is, they rely on buddhi to complete that interaction. They may not know exactly what it is, but they rely on that buddhi. This is the vijnanamaya kosha, and the anna that is fed to that is the manomaya kosha with all the data. Remember this, atti iti atma, every atma at every stage of the panchakosha, then only the panchakosha sadhana will be complete. Just as you do that, to control the prana and use it in a regular way, you want to control the prana, if you want to use it in a regular and rhythmic way, you have to do pranamaya. You have to do pranayama to control that prana. And you will notice, once you process the prana in that way, and feed it to the manomaya atma, then the manomaya atma becomes capable of thinking clearly. That is why you do pranayama before you do your japa, etc. And you do japa before you enter into deeper meditation. You're going from pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, and then maybe anandamaya. So what is according to the rules, what is right, what is not right, how to think these three things clearly, how to engage correctly in behavior, to practice all this is the sadhana of the manomaya kosha. So the Upanishad says all the rules, the entire Veda is present there in the manomaya kosha. Now to assimilate the manomaya kosha, when the power of decision making is to be used, then you need a higher order of yoga and you need to have intuition. And there in the Vijnanamaya kosha, there is yoga and there is Shraddha. It is there within you, but you have to awaken it. And hence, by the name of Yoga Abhyasa, some processes are told in the Shastra, which are merely facilitating tools, where the real thing that you have to do is to awaken that internal Vijnana. So a person for whom this happens, they develop a sophisticated and well-developed individuality and personality, and they're able to complete every work in an excellent way. Now, how does this happen and for whom does it happen is a very difficult question. And it needs to be thought about in a very subtle way at the level of experience. So, if the Vijnana is associated with a power that is above the senses and the mind, it works at a level beyond the internal sense organs and the external sense organs, and it's an important factor for our progress, then it's possible that beyond that buddhi also there is something. Where buddhi is not there, what is there? The Upanishad gives a stupendous answer, which when it gives it, you may not realize it's a stupendous answer. It says it is an anandamaya state. Now, two common mistakes when we hear this first from the Upanishad is we think we have come to the final stage. And of course, you're not come to the final stage. Because the Upanishad leaves you before you come to the final stage. It wants you to go to the final stage by yourself. Because Upanishad is not a cookbook. It is not going to give you a recipe that if you follow every day, the last recipe, the last instruction, you'll make the food, eat it and feel happy. It is not like that. The Upanishad takes you to the place where you can then go ahead by yourself. Okay, that is the first thing. The second thing is, the other surprising thing about this is, beyond buddhi, if you say buddhi is not working, we are inclined to say beyond the buddhi, what is there? There will be some dullness, there will be some emptiness, there will be some darkness. Okay. And as you prove this every day when the buddhi is not there during sleep, you feel the dullness and the darkness. That is known without doubt. So what else is there in deep sleep? There is only me and nothing else. There is only me and nothing else. Who is able to say that? Who is able to say there is only me and nothing else? So anandamaya is that by which I know me without any sadhana of knowing. Okay, anandamaya is that by which I know me without any sadhana of knowing. Who is that me? Once you ask, then it's clear that you don't know. So this means that although I know myself, I don't know that I know myself. Hence, to really know myself, I have to go beyond ananda also. This is a very, very subtle conversation that even the Upanishad doesn't get deeply into. And then at the end of it, it says, it starts describing people who have reached there and how they behave. It's not going to tell you how to go there. So as I told you, it is not a cookbook and it's not going to give you that recipe. So how to go forward from there, we'll see in the next time. Ushaji and Venkat sir, I'll stop my presentation today at this stage. And as usual, we can have some questions and I'll be happy to answer as much as I can.
The first question, what is the journey of prana after it leaves the body?
What is the journey of prana after it leaves the body? See, there it's certainly a valid question. But I want to keep the questions over here to be to stick to the subject. So there is, you know, the matter of prana after leaves the body, the journey. They are described in so many shastras. I am not an expert. First of all, number one, I am not an expert in those shastras. It doesn't mean that I can't tell you something about it, but I'm not an expert, so I will not be able to tell you definitively about it. Second is that this is not the topic we are staying at, so I might later on be able to recommend to you other things that you can read, but I would prefer not to try to answer that question in any you know, half measure and have any inaccuracies. So I hope you will.
Just to clarify, maybe the person is intending the sthula sharira, sukshma sharira and karana sharira. So in a subtle way you can answer that, sir. That is sthula, sukshma and
Acha, that way we can answer. No, if that is what is interesting, but he's asking, but he says the journey of prana after it leaves its body. So then prana goes, so you know, as Venkat sir says, there are these shariras. But you know, Ankay, Venkat sir, sorry to say that moment I tell about shariras, then I have to separate the panchakoshas into the shariras. Then I need to explain which sharira is in which kosha. Then I have to take a slightly different perspective on the panchakoshas. And then I have to talk about a little bit about what happens, as he asks, at death. What happens to Sula Sharira pass away? What happens to the Sukshma Sharira? What happened to Karana Sharira? It is all really good stuff to talk about. But it is just an elaborate sidetrack that I don't want to go into. So I might recommend to the person one interesting thing that you can do as a very concrete and a limited thing. There is a very basic, there are many texts, of course. There are Upanishadic texts, there are the Upanishads themselves, but there are many preparatory texts one reads to study the Upanishads. These are called Prakarana Granthas, okay? And they are not always to be studied before the Upanishads. Some of them are advanced, can be studied in the middle. So one is called Tattva Bodha. That defines a lot of things and what happens and what doesn't happen. So I might recommend that you take, either you go to Ramakrishna Ashram or Chinmaya Mission or Arshavidya, and one of these good sanstas, find their translated version of Tattva Bodha and perhaps have a look at it. It might be useful for you to answer some of the questions that I am unable to address in this.
Okay.
All right.
I think one more question, Mahodaya. Who is your guru? They have asked. Maybe.
Oh, that is a very good question. I can talk for another 5 classes about that. So, who is my guru? So, my guru is Swami Ishwarananda Giriji. Okay. So, that is his name. And by way of Parichaya, I will tell you that he is only parichaya we can give of guru. If anybody can guess, what is the parichaya you can give of guru? What, anybody can guess that? Only parichaya I can give of my guru is, who is his guru? So his guru is Swami Nrisimha Giri Maharaj of the Dakshinamurti Pitha in Kashi. And of him I can tell you his guru, etc. So the point about guru is that the Vedanta Parampara, you see, that all this information that I am merely sharing, after all, I wanted, at least, a very good, I'm so glad this question, there'll be no time for any other questions today because the answer to this will take up the rest of this session. So I wanted to also say this, that I said it in the first class, but perhaps people might not have been there in the first class, so I'll say it again. That if you see any shortcomings in what I'm saying, then you consider those shortcomings to be entirely my own. But if you see any brilliance and you see fantastic, that is, people write something, are wow, beautiful and all, nothing of that is due to me. I'm merely trying my best to convey to you what Swamiji has written in this book. he spoke somewhere, and I am just conveying that to you. So all those sparks of brilliance are just in those words and the way he puts it, which I will find, I will tell you, having listened to people all over the country of talking about Vedanta, it is very rare. And because it is not very rare because it is a very strange thing. It is rare because it is the original thing. So the original thing is that there is a guru parampara, which means there is a guru. And if you ask where he came from, we have to go to his guru. So let us fix one guru. Let us take Narasimha Giriji Maharaj, who is my guru's guru. And he is an embodiment, living embodiment of the Upanishadic knowledge. So not only has he has got, a guru will have two characteristics. They will be Shrotriya and Brahma Nishtha. These are the two things you have to check out in your guru. And you do have to check out your guru. So as long as you have some Adhikara, of course. Okay. So your guru will be Shrotriya and Brahma Nishtha. Shrotriya means he has deeply immersed himself in the Shruti, and he has the ability to communicate that Shruti to you in some way. Shrotriya, his words are based in Shruti. He's not coming up with some new stuff. Why? My guru, even an Arjuna's guru said the same thing to you. I am not telling anything new to you. He didn't say that in chapter 18 or something. He said it in chapter 3. He said, evam parampara praptam. This is not my stuff. I got it from somebody before. Parampara, evam parampara praptam imam rajarshayo viduhu. Everybody knew this. The rajarshis before knew this. Okay, but because it's Bhagavan speaking, he says, I only gave it to the first one. So, but when our guru speaks, he will not speak with that kind of language because it will be too shocking for us. So he will tell, I got it from my guru. Shrotriya from my guru. But Shrotriya is not good enough. He has to be Brahma Nishtha, which means he has taken those Shruti Vakyas, that Shruti he has taken, and he has incorporated it, immersed in it, and now that Shruti is bursting forth in another living form in his presence. It is living. He is Brahma Nishtha. It is now living Shruti. You can get, I'll take a book and show you a book. There's Shruti there. Why do I need to go Guru? Living. It has to be living. And when it is living, it has an ability to be communicated to you in a way that is just absolutely mind-blowing. So, that Guru that I have is a Guru who is Brahma Nishtha and apart from being Shrotriya, which means in every trivial act and in every trivial statement of his, for somebody who is living with him, we call that. So this is all very classic Upanishadic Vedantic concepts. The Guru is a Shrotriya Brahma Nishtha. You are the Antahavasi. You are the one who is staying close to him all the time. Okay, and you are doing Upa-asana, which means you are sitting close to him. Sitting close to him doesn't mean physically holding his legs. You are always close to what he is saying in your contemplation, etc. And then when that happens, it is like having an empty pitcher of water connected to a full pitcher of water that is at a higher level. The water flows helplessly into that empty pitcher of water. So when you do upasana, you are with that empty pitcher at the lower level. And then helplessly he does upadesha. He gives it. It's not an act of giving that he has to give like that. It'll just helplessly flow from guru to shishya if the right guru is there and the right shishya is there. So for that, you have to do guru seva. Now, guru seva doesn't mean pressing the legs, putting chandana and giving offerings. That is not seva. Seva is not service. Seva is meaning, it's a Sanskrit seva. Seva means exposure. You have to agree to expose yourself to the guru tattva. If you expose yourself to the Guru Tattva, when you are fully decided to denude yourself and expose yourself to the Guru Tattva, it is called Sharanagati. Okay, when you have decided to completely expose yourself to the Guru Tattva, it is called Sharanagati, and at that point, you have to say, like Arjuna said to his driver, Shishyasteham Shadhimam Tvam Prapannam. Yet, and then you have to say two things. You have to do Sharanagati. You have to say, Shishyasteham Shadhimam Tvam Prapannam, and you can't just sit there. You have to also say, Yachreyasyan Nishchitam Bruhitanni. You have to ask for it. You have to have the Adhikara. You have to do the Sharanagati. And then you have to ask for it, because in Vedanta there's a tradition, unless you are asked, you don't tell. So that not that you call some guy off the street and say, hey, come, be my Shishya, I'll tell you now Brahma Vidya. That's not the way. There has to be a person who has to come, he has to be hanging around you for a long time, which will be probably irritating for this, for the great gurus. And then somewhere the guru has to be able to see whether he has got the Adhikara, the Sharanagati, and the patrata. Patrata means, is he empty vessel enough to receive the upadesha? And in such a case, the upadesha is given. So that is, all this is to say, all this seems to be some kind of lecture on gurudom, which is not. I am describing my guru. My guru is an embodiment of these classical principles in an uncompromising way. In an uncompromising way, my guru was led a life in the 20th, 21st century, upholding these principles and yet dealing with a lot of common people like me and a few other people you see in this panelist list, able to give us something that we could then make our own. So that is my guru. His name is Swami Ishwaranandagiri, Giri, and there are many books that he has, and you could read them to get a glimpse on glimpse into the way he presented the Vedanta Shastras. So I hope I answered that question.
Yes, you are answered. When can I read your guru's work? Please suggest some books of your guru.
When you can read it. Anytime. When can I read my guru's work? Okay. So there are, I think what we'll do is somebody will be there. There are some people in this lecture. Digviraj Singh is there, and Shivangshu Gore is there. One is in Mount Abu, the other one is in Ahmedabad. There are bookshops. There are devotees here in Bangalore also who keep the book. I don't know, unfortunately, with the current situation, whether you can go and post books and do those things. But there are ways to get those books, and then I will look into what is possible now in the current situation, and I will let people know.
Last question: is there any reference of God in this Panchakosha Sadhana? Does a person need to be believer or non-believer in God to start this sadhana?
Does the person need to be a believer or not believer in God? Very good. Very good question. Person does not need to be a believer in God. But a person needs to believe in themselves. Without believing in yourself, you cannot enter into anything. So please don't worry about God and all. You worry about yourself. If you believe in yourself, if you are honest, if you are sincere, you can start any sadhana. You can start the Vedanta sadhana.
How do you find your guru? This we have already answered many times. Being a Grihini, can I get a guru too? Half the time I am spending with family.
Other half you find looking for a guru, then you'll get a guru. So anybody, there are a lot of Grihinis. I mean, there's nothing special about any one of us. All people have got a guru. Some people have not got a guru. Little bit prarabdha, a little bit of our self-effort also is there. So some combination of self-effort and prarabdha determine what you get.
Brahma vidha apnoti param. Can you please elaborate more? I think it is coming later.
It might come, it might not come, but now I cannot in the next 3 minutes elaborate Brahma vidha apnoti param.
Correct. I think Lester all comments, I think we can leave that. Please.
Comments. Okay, very good. So now we will continue next Sunday. ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। जय
बालाजी सर, विथ योर परमिशन कैन आई टेल समथिंग?
यस प्लीज।
इन दिस क्लास आई वुड लाइक टू से टुडे बालाजी सर टच्ड ऑन द पंचकोश विद्या इन तैत्तरीय उपनिषद। इफ समबडी नोस संस्कृत and if you want to have a detailed exposition of the Taittiriya Upanishad, only Taittiriya Upanishad, Vyoma Linguistic Labs have got each valli, about more than 15 to 20 classes per valli has been dealt by Professor Mahadevan. Of course you need to know some Sanskrit, and it is in English, but however Sanskrit knowledge is required to understand that. So people who have who already know Sanskrit and who have the time to go through those lectures in detail, which is 20 to 25 lectures per valli, it is there. You can just go through, and because we have it in our own portal, sanskritfromhome.in. Please go there and you can access from that that course page of it is called Taittiriya Upanishad only. It is called, each valli is having one course. Dhanyavad.
But Mahanarayana is not there in that, is it?
Mahanarayana is not there. Only the three ones, sir. Dhanyavada.
Dhanyavada.